The following episode of The Kingdom of Isolation contains footage from the film being discussed. The footage is used solely for the purposes of education, commentary, and criticism under fair use. Please support the animators by watching this film on Disney Plus or home media where available. This episode also contains spoilers throughout.
It is good to be back open for business. So with that being said, hello, my fellow Pixar fans, and welcome to the first episode of The Kingdom of Isolation for 2024, when times of trouble, why not celebrate the magic of Pixar? And today, we are going to be looking at WALL-E, released in 2008. It is good to be back from the Christmas break, even though it's been about it's been about 6 weeks since I last did an episode. But regardless, it is so good to be back. I've taken a break from making King of Isolation content because it's been that 2 to 3 month stretch of me just boom 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 boom, episode after episode after episode. I'm feeling refreshed, and I'm ready to go. So, I still can't believe I managed to get through every animated classic done in the Disney Animated Classics lineup. And now we're going to do the same with Pixar. So, here we go. We are still in the middle of peak Pixar here, with so much love for Ratatouille, WALL-E, the subject of today's episode, Up, and Toy Story 3. Which is no mean feat. It is no mean feat on that one, especially with the latter two of these four being nominated for Best Overall Picture at the Oscars, which we'll get into in due course. Now, I'm going to start incorporating more regarding the deleted scenes now that I have some more time on my hands to make these episodes even better. So anyway, I'm rambling on a little. So I say let's get into another beloved gem from Pixar's catalog. So one interesting thing about this film before we get started is that this is the first film that Disney and Pixar collaborated with the Criterion Film Collection Company on. And this film got added to the Criterion Collection in 2022. Spine 1167 in the collection for those that want the specifics. The film's working title was Trash Planet, and to explore the possibilities of pure visual storytelling. And I'm on board with that. Sometimes all you need are the visuals, the story, and the music to go with it as well. So, here we go. Andrew Stanton and the Pixar team watched every single Charlie Chaplin and Buster Keaton movie, both short films and the features, every day during lunch for about 18 months. Whew. I wonder how many that would be. Now, normally, about 75,000 storyboards are used on average for a Pixar film. But in this case, add an extra 50,000 on top of that. 125,000 storyboards. That's a lot of storyboards, folks. That's a lot of storyboards. Now, the concept for the film evolved from a now famous lunch that took place between John Lasseter, Pete Docter, and Joe Ranft in 1994. Toy Story was nearing completion at the time, and the writers sat down to brainstorm ideas for their next projects. Out of this lunch was born WALL-E, Bug's Life, Monsters, Inc., and Finding Nemo. Stanton and Docter outlined the film before Toy Story was completed, but production would not resume until after Stanton completed Finding Nemo. Now, Steve Jobs also did not like the film's title when Stanton showed an early draft of the film to him and Lasseter back in 2004. As a response, Andrew renamed it from WALL-E, which is W-A-L-E, to the Wall-E that we all know and love today. Okay, so the world has kind of already ended here at this point. Okay, nothing but trash for miles around. Even with a jaunty 1930s tune in the background. Am I watching Wall-E or am I playing Fallout here? Now, in the opening scene, there are wind turbines and nuclear plants built on top of trash mounds, implying that mankind didn't convert to clean energy until it was too late. A not-so-subtle environmental message here, folks. Especially with what we're dealing with right now. Now, originally, Andrew Stanton wanted to use 1930s French swing music for the opening, but decided he couldn't after seeing the triplets of Belleville, which he deemed to be too similar, if you will. Now, we don't really have a specific time frame on when this is set, but thanks to a DVD extra entitled Burn-E, in which the events take place at the same time as the film, we can timestamp the year of AD 2805, so we're talking just under 600 years into the future. Now, we see our titular robot friend cleaning up the trash somewhat and turning it into trash cubes. Now, that little cockroach's sounds were achieved by speeding up raccoon sounds. Nice job on the sound design team. So much easier with sound editing today than it was when, say, Cinderella was released in 1950. Some of the other pieces of sound design include insect clicks made by locking handcuffs, the wind being a bag dragged along a carpet, among a few others we'll get into later. The cockroach ends up being named Hal by the Pixar team, referencing not just silent producer Hal Smith, but also Hal 9000 from 2001, A Space Odyssey. And that's not the only reference we're going to get to that from that film later on. So, the survival of both Twinkies and cockroaches, the Twinkie and the cockroach, perpetuates the urban myth that even should the world end, both will survive indefinitely. WALL-E actually stands for Waste Allocation Load Lifter Earth Class. Now, the name's also a nod to Walt himself, Walter Elias Disney. That's quite a jump from jaunty, happy-go-lucky 1930s music to eerie dystopian music score. Wall-E is voiced by Ben Burtt, who's been very pivotal in the sound department on a number of projects over the years, including the Star Wars franchise. Ben had just completed Star Wars Episode III: Revenge of the Sith in 2005 and told his wife that he never wanted to work on another film that involved robots. Well, at least he managed to skip out on Blue Sky's robots. But in his eyes, he's happy he skipped out on Blue Sky's robots, which ended up being bought out by Disney, and then the studio got closed down because reasons. Anyway. He changed his mind when Pixar talked through their ideas for this film, which he found to be fresh and exciting. Ben recorded his sounds in a junkyard, which gave an authentic feel to how Wall-E sounds on Earth. Wall-E has also been heavily compared to the robot Number 5, aka Number Johnny 5, in Short Circuit upon release. However, Stanton insisted that it was more coincidence rather than influence. Now, Wall-E's eyes were inspired by a pair of binoculars that was given to Stanton when he was watching an Oakland Athletics versus Boston Red Sox baseball game. Seemingly, Stanton missed the entire first inning because he was so distracted by the binoculars. He also claimed that the film's central theme was that irrational love can defeat everything, including programming. And most of the robots here are actually voiced by Ben Burtt through mechanical sounds of his creation. He recorded 2,500 different sounds for the film, twice the average of a Star Wars movie, and also the most that Burtt had ever recorded for one feature film. His involvement with the film lasted for 2 years. And when Andrew Stanton met with Burtt to pitch the idea of him working on the film, he told him, "I need you to be 80% of my cast." With Joel Grantham passed away in 2005, this makes Wall-E Andrew Stanton's first directorial effort to not have any characters voiced by Joel Grantham. I've brought up numerous times, Joel Grantham, he's done a lot in the world of Pixar before he passed away in 2005. Some of his roles included Lenny, I think he was, the binoculars in Toy Story. He was Wheezy as well. And of course, everyone's favorite hungry German caterpillar, Heimlich. Francis, leave them alone, they are poo-poo heads! And back to the music, and it's Thomas Newman back in action. Last time he was in action in The Kingdom of Isolation, he composed the music for Finding Nemo. Now, the newspaper that's shown at the beginning of the film has a photo of Shelby Fortnite, B&L's CEO. That's by and large, CEO. Doing the infamous Richard Nixon resignation hand sign. The music here is a bit unsettling, as it definitely emphasizes that this could happen to us if we don't take care of our planet. Now, part of me is convinced that I'm watching something akin to the Fallout games, which I've just brought up earlier. Now, according to the DVD extras, the Axiom is a General Dynamics Type 3 hull configuration, which is similar in name and shape to the General Products Number 3 hull featured in the classic science fiction novel Ringworld by Larry Niven. So there's a lot of science fiction influences and in references, influences, and Easter eggs and inspiration. Now, side note.
And with our all-access hover chairs, even Grandma can join the fun. There's no need to walk.
No need to walk? That doesn't bode well if this ends up being our future. In logic and math, an axiom is something unquestionable or taken for granted. Wall-E's humming is so adorable here, as we see some artifacts from the past, including a Rubik's Cube and the Dinocrone logo. Another recurring Pixar Easter egg. The movie Wall-E watches is the music Hello Dolly, which Lionel Newman worked on. The director, Andrew Stanton, chose it because he played the character Barnaby in high school. And the movie does teach Wall-E about love and how it's used to juxtapose something old-fashioned compared to this apocalyptic futuristic setting. As he explained in an interview with EW Entertainment Weekly, Wall-E collects numerous objects from the 1960s and to the 1980s, including a Rubik's Cube and even an Atari 2600 with the game Pong. Thank goodness it wasn't E.T., which caused the video game crash of 1983. Despite the film taking place over 800 years after these objects were created, all the objects are still in working condition. And this is this moment is so full of awesomeness. No, Perito, it's not cuteness overload. Side note, this is also the first time live-action footage has been used in a Pixar film. Now, Wall-E is almost caught in what looks like a sandstorm. Thankfully, the carrier keeps him and Hal safe. Yep. We can all relate, he's definitely not a morning person. Oh no, he even loses his tracks! Hello, Macintosh startup! Specifically, the iMac G3. Great homage to Steve Jobs and Apple, who bought Pixar in 1986 from Lucasfilm before Disney bought Pixar in 2006 for $7 billion, and then Lucasfilm in 2012 for $4 billion. Please be okay, please be okay, please be okay. Oh, thank goodness he's okay. So many finds throughout the day for Wally, including a ring. Could you save that ring for me? Hey, no, don't throw the ring away! That fire extinguisher, a fire extinguisher becomes important later, albeit a different, my point's there. That fire extinguisher becomes important later, albeit a different one. Or to simplify it, a fire extinguisher becomes important later for one of the best scenes in this film. Now, it looks like Wally managed to find a plant inside a fridge. Hopefully not the same one Indiana Jones used to survive being nuked in King of the Crystal Skull. Have you ever heard the term jump the shark? Indiana Jones invented the term nuked the fridge. Hang on, when did Wally become a cat thanks to that light? Oh, that's not good. Those lights look more like a targeting system. Okay, never mind. It was just the engines from a ship, which leaves Wally traumatized. Oh my word! This is where we get introduced to EVE, which stands for Extraterrestrial Vegetation Evaluator. She's voiced by Alyssa Knight, I think, who worked for Pixar at the time of the film's release. Oh my word, can this film stop scarring our favourite little robot, please? This is more like it, Thomas. More of this music, please. I admire the contrast between Wally's rusted look compared to Eve's being, ooh, shiny. Hey, why did you just do that? Please don't hurt me. Poor tires. A lot of them never used in a Formula One race. Eve, tone it down! Wally makes a statue overnight that includes the Luxo Jr. lamp. Ooh! Hello, Pizza Planet truck! The sound of Eve's laser blasts are partly created by tapping a slinky spring. And it looks like one of those crane magnets is working, somehow. Scratch that. Eve says magnets must die! That's actually quite satisfying to see. The destruction of corporate property who only focus on making money and nothing else.
Thank you!
Wally. Okay, Perito, now you can say your line. Right, okay. I couldn't work out how to incorporate... Julie, do the thing! I couldn't work out how to incorporate that, so this will have to do for now. Actually, come in to think of it. Let's see if this works.
Julie, do the thing.
The first three human languages that Eve uses when speaking to Wally for the first time are German, Japanese, and Swahili, before she finally settles down for English and says directive. Wally saves Eve from the sandstorm, and this is definitely a highlight for many fans of the film. The relationship between Wally and Eve. There's that. Oh, there's that beautiful song again as Wally shows Eve the plant he found earlier. Okay, that music's worrying. That music is worrying. Wally stays by her side, determined to get her back up and running. Reluctantly, he gets back to work before the same ship that dropped Eve off picks her back up. Wally heads into space, looking in wonder at what's around him, including some Apollo Easter eggs. For those that don't know, the Apollo is where you had these space missions that involved the lunar landings. The Apollo space program involving lunar exploration. Apollo 11 in 1969, one small step for man, one giant leap for mankind. And then, of course, you have Apollo 13, Houston, we have a problem. Now, when Wally is riding on the outside of the rocket traveling back to the Axiom, some of the imagery is similar to the opening credit sequence for Star Trek Voyager. Specifically, the sun with the solar flare and the planet with the rings. Oh, my word, 16 years on and those visuals still look amazing. To achieve the filmic look, the Pixar animators brought in some vintage 1970s Panavision cameras, similar to the ones used to shoot the original Star Wars Episode IV, A New Hope, and shot some imagery to get an idea of what it should look like. We finally make it to the Axiom, and the next robot is M.O. Hey, what's your M.O.? Who helps sterilize the robots? Security ends up taking Eve away, and this is a future I am definitely not a fan of. Earth is nothing but trash, and the humans are too lazy to do any walking. Just lounging around on their chairs all day.
By and large, everything you need to be happy.
Oh, hello, Sigourney Weaver. Not the last time we... It will be the last time we hear you in a Pixar film. The humans have become that lazy, they become babies unable to walk.
Stuart! Hello!
Yes, that was John Ratzenberg, everyone, voicing John. Ah! 8113! We get introduced to the captain, who I initially thought was voiced by John Ratzenberger. But it's actually Jeff Garlin, who's best known for Curb Your Enthusiasm.
Manuel, relay instructions.
Captain, you have to physically turn the pages to physically read it. This is what happens when you become too dependent on technology.
Voice authorization required. Accepted.
That was easy. And then again, maybe not. While the captain's learning about Earth, Eve and Wally are heading to the repair world. The People Mover transportation system is an homage to the old Disney attraction, Wedway People Mover, which was located in Tomorrowland from 1967 to 1997. Small side note regarding auto. MacIntalk is used to provide the voice for auto. Yes, MacIntalk is the text-to-speech program. Wally is worried that Eve is being taken apart, but she's actually being taken care of until Wally takes the arm and fires a laser, which ends up being something that causes the repair wall to shut down and all the robots to escape. Eve and Wally are now classed as rogue robots, so naturally, security are after them.
Caution. Rogue robots.
Yeah. Screw your cautions, ship. Eva Wally gets to one of the pods, and one of the security bots has the plant, ejecting the pod with Wally inside. The pod self-destructs, and thankfully, Wally's okay, as well as the plant. And now, best scene of the film, the space dance. So much beauty in the visuals, music, and story here. Mary and John also hold hands for the first time here. And on the subject, the production had to cheat on the shot from Hello Dolly, which features the lovers holding hands. In the 1969 film, there was no close-up of the hand-holding. So Pixar was permitted to take the original film element and go in a little tighter on it. So they would have had a way of zooming in on that particular shot, that particular part of that shot, while not losing any of the picture quality. As described in a special feature on the film's DVD and Blu-ray releases, the inhabitants of the Axiom were originally going to be aliens led by a royal family, with a penchant for mistreating its robots, I should say. Stanton eventually scrapped the alien idea, and one of the early concepts for the evolution of humans in space for 700 plus years was that they would become how do you pronounce that? Gelatinous, boneless, legless, see-through, green creatures that resemble jello. The makers consulted with to more solid grey blobs, and then finally, the final big baby concept. The makers consulted with a live-action director of photography, Roger Deakins, to learn how Deakins would light and shoot a scene if it were a live-action movie. Much of the film's first half bears an atmospheric, sepia-hued look that characterizes much of Deakins' film work. Wally searches for Eve, the captain waters the plant, and also reenacts that moment from Space Odyssey. I'm sorry, Captain. I'm afraid I can't do that.
On the Axiom, you will survive.
I don't want to survive! I want to live!
Hey, look, I'm with Captain on that one. I'd rather be living than just surviving or existing.
Eve, you were to put this plant straight in the hollow detector. No!
This is why AI will always be a problem. Eve and Wally are in the airlock disposal, which is not good. Emo cleans Wally while Eve looks for a new chip to help Wally.
Please hold. We are currently having...
Rogue robot. Revolution time, and the steward bots have been wiped out. The Axiom is about to get evacuated. Otto goes full rogue and tries to kill Wally, and the captain's had enough.
Otto, you are relieved of duty.
Ah, birth of man time. Everyone gets back to Earth, but Eve thinks she's lost Wally after what he went through. Thankfully, everything's okay, and the captain teaches everyone about farming. Although Peter Gabriel wrote and sang the closing song, it's highly reminiscent of Randy Newman, who wrote the score for 9 Pixar films. Andrew Stanton is a big fan of Peter Gabriel, who was very enthused to write the song Down to Earth, because he loved Finding Nemo. The film was dedicated to Justin Wright, who passed away from a heart attack at just 27 years old. You'll also have seen at the start of the episode that this episode is dedicated to the memory of Glynis Johns, who passed away just a few weeks ago at the age of 100, where she was best known for playing Mrs. Banks in the 1964 classic Mary Poppins, which I've covered previously here in The King of Isolation. So rest in peace, Glynis Johns. Now, on to the scores, methinks. Well, not really much else I could say here, because it's been very difficult to fault this film. The story gets a 10, it's well paced. It's a great story about how a lot of the storylines that we see, a lot of them I've talked about previously, how love can overcome anything, including the programming of the robots. There's a lot of great references to some great sci-fi classics. The characters also get a 10. They're well written. Yes, Wally and Eve are mostly robotic sounds throughout the film, but it's the chemistry we see between the two that just makes their relationship so wholesome. Absolutely incredible. The visuals, they get an 11. I cannot fault these. Those visuals in space, that's the wow factor that gets the 11. Plus that space dancing. Need I say more beyond that? The soundtrack definitely gets a 10. Down to Earth, a beautiful song over the end credits. And also the score by Thomas Newman. Fantastic throughout. So now on to the legacy of the film. So we're going to head into the your standard stuff, your critical reception, yada, yada, yada. Now, the American Film Institute named Wall-E as one of the best films of 2008, with the jury rationale stating, Wall-E proves to this generation that beyond the film's medium, only true boundaries are the human Wall-E proves to this generation and beyond that the film medium's only true boundaries are the human imagination. Andrew Stanton and his team have created a classic screen character from a metal trash compactor who rides to the rescue of a planet buried in debris that embodies the broken promise of American life. Not since Chaplin's Little Tramp has so much story, so much emotion been conveyed without words. When hope arrives in the form of a seedling, the film blossoms into one of the great screen romances as two robots remind audiences of the beating heart in all of us that yearns for humanity and love in the darkest of landscapes. This film's got 95% on Rotten Tomatoes, with the website consensus reading, Wall-E's stellar visuals testify once again to Pixar's ingenuity, while its charming star will captivate younger viewers, and its timely story offers thought-provoking subtexts. At Metacritic, which assigns a normalized rating to reviews from mainstream critics, the film has an average score of 95 out of 100 based on 39 reviews, indicating universal acclaim. Audiences polled by CinemaScore gave the film an average rating of A on an A+ to F scale. Now, Roger Ebert of the Chicago Times. We've brought up Roger Ebert's name previously here in The Kingdom of Isolation. Now, he's named Wall-E an enthralling animated film, a visual wonderment, and a decent science fiction story, and said the scarcity of dialogue would allow it to cross language barriers in a manner appropriate to the global theme, and noted it would appeal to adults and children. He praised the animation, describing the color palette as bright and cheerful and a little bit realistic, and that Pixar managed to generate a curious regard for the Wall-E, comparing his rusty and hardworking and plucky design favorably to more obvious attempts at creating lovable lead characters. He said Wall-E was concerned with ideas rather than spectacle, saying it would trigger stimulating little thoughts for the younger viewers. He named it as one of his 20 favorite films of 2008 and argued it was the best science fiction movie in years. I can't really fault that. I cannot fault that. And In 2021, the film was selected for preservation in the National Film Registry by the Library of Congress as being culturally, historically, and aesthetically significant. And now the accolades. Silly me. I forgot about the box office. Now, WALL-E grossed $223.8 million in USA and Canada and $308.7 million overseas for a worldwide total of $532.5 million, making it the ninth highest grossing film of 2008. So that's definitely not bad. Over $10 million in Japan. And the $44 million in Japan, $41 million in the UK, Ireland, and Malta, nearly $28 million in France and the Maghreb region, $24 million in Germany, $17 million in Mexico, nearly $15 million in Spain, $14 million in Australia, $12 million in Italy, and $11 million in Mother Russia and the CIS, which is the Commonwealth of Independent States. Well, like I said, time for the accolades. It got nominated for 6 Oscars that year. Best Original Screenplay, Best Original Score, Best Original Song, Best Sound Editing, and Best Sound Mixing. And it won for Best Animated Feature. At the Annies. Wow, that's a bit of a shock. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. 7 Annie nominations and it didn't win any. So if that was... So it was nominated for Best Animated Feature, but it didn't win. Oh, Kung Fu Panda, right, that checks out. Kung Fu Panda, right, checks out. Fair play. Let's see, the BAFTAs got nominated for Best Film Music and Best Sound, and it won for Best Animated Film as well. Best Feature Film at the British Academy Children's Awards. Golden Globes, nominated for Best Original Song with Down to Earth and won Best Animated Film. Grammys. 1, 2, 3 nominations, and it won for 2 of them. Best Instrumental Arrangement, which was for the part of the score Define Dancing. And then Thomas Newman and Peter Gabriel also won Best Song Written for Motion Picture, Television, or Other Visual Media with Down to Earth. And it was nominated for Best Score Soundtrack Album for Motion Picture, Television, or Other Visual Media. Now, what would it have won? Ah, The Dark Knight. Again, fair play. 2008 was a hell of a year for films. Start of the MCU, you had Kung Fu Panda, and you had this little, and you had this lovable gem. Right, next. What else do we have? Those are like all the major ones. Ah, Saturn Award. It won a Saturn Award for Best Animated Film. I think that's all the main ones. Ah! Teen Choice Awards, Best Summer Comedy Movie. Would we call this film a comedy? I don't know. And it was Get Smart that won that. Okay, so you've got to mix it. That Get Smart, that won over Kung Fu Panda? Huh. You'd have thought. Hang on. Kids' Choice Awards. Favorite animated movie. At the Kids' Choice Awards. And they chose Madagascar. They chose Madagascar over Kung Fu Panda? Wow. That being said, the legacy still gets a 10, so we get a very respectable score of 102%. So, where does that put it on the board? Well, it is joint with Finding Nemo. It's a toss-up between these two. So we'll say joint fourth. Because I can't separate the two. Well, I mean, the two Pixar films that Thomas Newman has composed music for, and they both have the same score. Oh, what were the chances of that happening? So, that being said, that's it for this episode of Cube of Isolation. So the next episode, we are going to be looking at Up. This is another beloved gem from Pixar's catalogue, and I'm very much looking forward to going through that in the next episode. So, hope you enjoyed this episode of the Kingdom of Isolation. If you did, hit the thumbs up, and if you want to be part of the Kingdom of Isolation yourself, you can hit the subscribe button down at the bottom, click the bell, turn on notifications so you don't miss when an episode goes live on this channel. But until then, folks, I'll see you guys next time in the Kingdom of Isolation.